I'm Mitch Easter, and my band of the era in question was called Let's Active.
I'm Bob Hay from Athens, Georgia, and I was in the Squalls.
My name is Peter Holsapple. I'm a member of a band called the DBs.
My name is Sherry Cothren. I'm from Meadville, Mississippi.
Mark Reynolds. I'm from Birmingham, Alabama. Play in Carnival Season.
I'm Vanessa Briscoe Hay. I was in the band Pylon.
I'm Tim Lee. I grew up in Jackson, Mississippi. I live in Knoxville, Tennessee. I played in the Windbreakers.
My name is David Bean. I played with the Judys. I was the lead singer, played guitar and keyboard.
And TV.
And television.
I'm Jeff Walton. I was in the Judys. I played bass.
Windbreakers started in Jackson, Mississippi, probably right around 79, 80. Bobby Sutliff and I were the two main people, and we kept it going off and on for about the next 10 years. We made, I don't know, six albums, something like that, and, you know, toured the country and beyond.
The band got started when we were in high school. I had spent a summer before my senior year in Austin, doing a science program at the University of Texas, and I came back and had seen some of the punk and new wave bands in the scene there. So I came back very excited and said, I think we can get in a club and we can start playing if we can really do this.
And originally there were four of us. So we had Sam Roush on guitar, and then we went in and recorded the first single, and then shortly after that, and I don't remember the timeline exactly, but he was killed in a car accident. So then it was the three of us.
Yeah, we decided to kind of use that minimal sound to our advantage. Because I was a very, and still am, a very limited guitar player. So we thought that will kind of be our unique sound, is just very minimal.
I didn't start Pylon. The guitarist Randy Bewley and Michael Lahusky, they came up with the idea while we were all in art school at UGA. They just decided on, I don't know if it was a whim or what, that they would form a band and go to New York, play once, and then break up. Then they started looking for a vocalist, and they couldn't find a vocalist. And they were almost ready to give up. They were using this record called Teacher Bird to Talk. They'd just about given up. They'd run through all of their male friends, and then Randy went, what about Vanessa?
Brad Quinn and I, the bass player in Carnival Season, we had been in a band called The Barking Tribe, and the original lineup of The Barking Tribe. And after that band kind of fell apart, we decided to move on and start our own band. It was kind of like this real incestuous kind of, you know, scene of players, and we kind of came together that way and just started doing our own thing. Started doing demos within a month of forming.
I moved here when I was 18, and when I came to Jackson, I pretty much came with the purpose of having a band. I was living in a small town. I was writing songs then. I had notebooks full of songs that I'd written. I wanted to be in a punk band, and when I got here, I thought, okay, I looked around. There wasn't any of that going on. So I thought, well, okay, this is what I need to do, so let's just start our own band. So I had a friend, Carla, who was working at a radio station here in town, WZZQ, and she had a punk show. So of course I met her on purpose, so, you know, and we bonded and we thought, let's get our band together.
We started up in the early 80s. I think our first show was 81, December of 81 or 82. We started out, we were just jamming. You know, in people's living rooms.
So DBs are all guys from Winston-Salem, North Carolina. We all grew up together in the 60s and 70s there. We went to New York at different times. Chris Stamey, who is the leader of the band, left after having a band in North Carolina called Sneakers. And Chris moved to New York to play bass for Alex Chilton from Big Star. And after a while, he decided he was going to start another band. of his own and called Will and our friend Gene Holder, who was in Philadelphia at the time. And they started the band in 1978, and I joined in the fall of 1978.
Well, I've been playing in bands since I was 12, but by the time that sort of 80s kind of era came along, I was like in my sort of mid-20s and a little bit freaking out that I didn't have anything going on. My girlfriend had started playing bass, so I was like, well, you want to play bass? And you know, and it was like that. It was like, it didn't have any past. And that was sort of really right for the times, you know? It was the sort of era where you really couldn't admit it if you knew how to play almost, you know? And I guess a lot of people that I knew just were thinking on my behalf, because I had two different people say, there's this girl in Chapel Hill you should definitely talk to about the band, and it was Sarah Reimweber. So we did, Faye and I met her, and we did sort of keep bugging her until she finally came up and played with us, and that's where that band came from. The thing that made it really happen, though, was that R.E.M. was coming in the studio, and somehow or other it came up that we had something going on, and they just said, well, we're playing at the 688 in Atlanta in 2 weeks, you want to open? So we had to get it together in those 2 weeks and go play that show, and that was a very cool show, you know, for us, and it was a good place to start.
The B-52s came and saw us about the fourth or fifth time we played, and we were playing this house out in the country. The windows were all open, and you could, it was very hot, and everyone was dancing. And the wind just started moving in and out the room like a huge speaker. So Kate and Fred thought we were great, and they said, give us a tape, and we'll take it to New York, and we'll get you booked. We took a cassette recorder, recorded a practice, and then made some copies on very cheap tape. And they took it to New York, and we were booked into Hurrah.
Jackson, at that time, there was no original music. There were no places to play original music. You know, there were a couple of people who made 45s, and that was about it. And so then, so like everybody else, we played a lot of Beatles songs and some punk rock and whatever. We eventually had more and more of our songs. We made our own record.
We did a contest to make a record, so to speak, and we ended up winning that. So then we, that next weekend, just got our songs together to make the 45.
We kind of rearranged the band a little bit, made some changes, and started working on trying to get into clubs and get a single made, get some recording, and tried to use that as a promotional tool for clubs to book us.
We put out these two EPs. The second one came out, and we immediately started having these independent labels offer to put out our records. So, and we were one of the first bands on Homestead Records. And we did one record for them, and then after that, they wanted us to do another one, but so did DB Records, and so did Restless, and all these other labels. So we ended up going with DB Records in Atlanta because Danny Beard was a friend of ours, and you know, so that's kind of the way I've always done business. I'd rather deal with people that are friends than people I don't know.
We signed with a record label and publishing company out of London called Albion Records, and hoped against all hope that we would be able to release records in the States, but no one picked us up.
Before I knew how to play anything, I remember hearing a few records that had electric guitar solos on them and thinking, what is that? And the sound just like was really riveting to me, you know, so I was interested in that sound. And my parents always listened to the radio, like radio was always on. They always listened to like Top 40, which back then meant everything, you know. A lot of rock music.
The radio in those days, if you look at the tune decks, and they've got James Brown, and they've got Paul Revere and the Raiders, they've got Dionne Warwick, and they've got the Bubble Puppy, and you know, and obviously waiting around for every 6 weeks for a new Beatles single to come out so that you could just get blown away by that. That was all so good.
I love all that real colorful, trippy, echoey, psychedelic stuff, but also I like the catchy pop songs that that sound is based on.
In the late 70s, there was this sort of power pop thing that started happening, and we became aware of, I mean, and some of these things like Big Star and Flamin' Groovies had already been around. We started becoming more aware of that kind of thing. The Dwight Twilley Band, and we were just kind of taken with this music, and we really wanted to play that. And so that was kind of the impetus behind the Windbreakers starting.
We were really into Badfinger and Big Star and the Raspberries, and a band called Blue Ash, and you know, lots of good, what is now sort of the primogenitors of power pop. And we really especially love Big Star. That those records really resonated with us tremendously. Some say that we are kind of that go-between band between Big Star and REM.
Chilton became a pretty big influence, I think, on everybody in Carnival season.
You know, people always say anybody that had Big Star records started bands, and there's a lot of truth to that, but you know, it was like a rite of initiation. You meet somebody and you had to know if they had a copy of Radio City, whether you could really, before you could really talk to them or not. You know, you had to know what approach to take in talking to them. And so there was something about that, that made it like a little club of sorts. We started finding out about the sneakers and the DBs and these North Carolina guys. And that was like huge because they were, you know, current, and they were, you know, kind of putting out, they were still kind of putting out their own records at that point, and they were from the South, you know. It was a big deal, you know, to me, that, you know, it was really made you see, wow, okay, people from the South can do this.
I had a lot of people say stuff to me like, you know, when I saw you, I realized, well, if that guy can do it, I can do it. And I do think that, like, I don't know, it's the Southerners have a funny inferiority complex, and maybe they need one of their own to show that it can be done.
Even though we didn't really return to Chapel Hill or to Winston-Salem except on tours, I think it gave our friends from the area hope that they could do something along those same lines.
I remember feeling those same things when I would find out somebody was from the South. And one that I remember really well was seeing the Box Tops on American Bandstand doing the letter. So then I was like 12 or something. And they, you know, interviewed Alex Chilton after that, and he was like a Southerner. And I was like, whoa, is this possible?
What I was listening to when I was moving to Jackson, right before then, I had The Clash, The Sex Pistols, The Ramones. I saw The Runaways, and I thought, you know, that's really what I want to do, is that with the guitar. And my graduation gift was a Stratocaster.
The late 70s were pretty rough. You know, if you didn't know about the punk stuff coming on, you were just listening to the radio. People were just so anxious for it.
I can vividly remember my dad coming in to when I was a teenager and asking me when all the hoopla was happening about the Sex Pistols at the time. And I remember my dad like, you don't listen to this crap, do you? It's like, no, but I think I will.
Once that kind of like punk thing got going again, it was totally okay to play your set of your songs and do those like new wave sets that lasted like 20 minutes. And the whole thing just like happened, which was totally my cup of tea, and I was really happy about it. So I think, you know, we got a real, I mean, we were just very lucky. It was super fertile ground everywhere you went.
That scene was just starting. The punk, the whole, you know, pissed off type mentality was forming then, and we were right there to help that along.
There really weren't that many bands touring. There weren't that many clubs to play. So when you did show up in, you know, whatever town it was, usually you would have a good turnout.
This was an era where there were only X number of bands in the entire United States doing this stuff. But there were starting to be labels, there were starting to be venues, there were starting to be fanzines and booking agents and things like that. So we just kind of hit at the exact right moment. My wife Susan and I started bringing in bands like Rain Parade and the Neats and the Liars and Reno Red, bands like that. And so we were really working hard to try to make sort of a scene, you know, and we had our little record label, Big Monkey Records, and we were encouraging our friends to make records, and there were other people that were. I mean, so it was really trying to build a scene in spite of itself.
There was a scene, but I never felt like we were part of that scene. We were younger, and I remember just sort of being almost afraid of some of them. I remember being up an early show and people sort of laughing at us.
Birmingham really, I don't know, it really wasn't a big scene here. It was definitely, you know, between us and several other bands locally, it was kind of like, well, we're just going to make our own scene pretty much.
Every little pocket was kind of different, you know, as you kind of expanded out from our little corner of the Deep South. Like, the bands in Athens were definitely based more on kind of a party scene and all this.
That was a happening place, and we ended up touring there, playing there on our tours, and yeah, I mean, that's a lot was coming from that area.
It felt like we were in the far, austere, cold north up here after coming back from Athens.
Athens at that time was a very supportive place. We were, you know, able to get away with a lot of things maybe that kids now can't. You know, not that we were running wild, but you know, we had late night parties and pretty much took over downtown because there's nothing else there.
Downtown was like a ghost town, which is one reason I think there kind of was a scene, is because there was so much space available, you could rent a studio for next to nothing.
You see that happen again and again through the ages, where you'll have an area that's inexpensive and there's a fertile ground for whatever reason, the right people are there, professors, or, you know, it creates the right climate for this artistic blossoming.
The B-52s were the only band that was like famous. They had just kind of become famous.
And at that time, they were the hottest thing in the music scene, really.
The B-52s were amazing, you know, and totally like mind-blowing.
I think after R.E.M., I think people just started moving here.
The fruits of R.E.M.'s labor, you know, everybody kind of, you know, I think profited from that somewhat that were in the South at the time.
R.E.M. helped me a lot. I mean, they had been in the studio and that's how I knew them, but then they like had us go tour with them and stuff.
We were very fortunate that we were friends with R.E.M. from the get-go also, and they were, as they ascended the staircase, they provided us with a lot of opportunities.
They definitely got the attention of New York, and eyes kind of turned south a little bit.
The thing that really changed the game was when R.E.M. got famous, but those guys got famous because they worked their asses off. They were a machine, you know, and they really, really worked at it, and they were good, and they had this amazing sort of energy and charisma, so they kind of had to get famous. But when they did, it kind of changed the game across the board, and which was maybe sort of the downside of it.
They were kind of the first band from the South, you know, other than, you know, Skinner or something like that, which was like not what any of us were about.
You know, at that time, Southern bands still implied you sounded like Skinner or Molly Hatchet or something. And not that there's anything wrong with that, but it had a connotation at the time.
We took it upon ourselves to try to let people in Winston-Salem and their, you know, in the area of other stuff other than what they were hearing on the radio at that point, which was all sort of Allman Brothers and Marshall Tucker, and you know, that stuff was fine, but it didn't really float our boats particularly.
There was a time when I was sort of depressed about like Southern rock, because it was not my cup of tea, you know. I was listening to The Move, you know. I didn't want to hear about bluesy stuff at all in that vibe, you know. I mean, I totally appreciate what that stuff is, but it wasn't my cup of tea.
We were definitely not the whiskey drinking, you know, rebel flag kind of crowd.
I think we did kind of, in that punkish new wave way of thinking, kind of wanted to separate ourselves from that. I don't think we set out going, we're going to be a Southern band, but we were very aware of it. It didn't take us long to kind of realize that, okay, we're Southern. We taught that way, we lived there.
I just thought it was ridiculous to run from, you know, your identity. And besides, the South is sort of an amusing place. It's the official underdog of the country. It's where all the weirdos are from, you know. But it's got like some really high quality stuff you can't argue with about it.
We've all, you know, come from our own sense of place, but it's not just a place, it's who we are.
I think, period, if you're from the South, you kind of have a thing about it, because this is where it kind of came from to begin with. We all, whether we want to admit it or not, I think everybody kind of has that or carries it inside of them.
I did feel different than the New York scene, because I had, as a kid, I had always read the rock magazines with the scene up there with the Ramones and Patti Smith, Talking Heads, etc. So I knew that that was a very elite and special group, mostly because of their location.
When we got up to New York City, I think that the folks that were up there saw us as, you know, Sheriff Andy Taylor and his pals. I mean, we sort of cultivated the Southern thing.
I had a good time, you know, going to New York and being talking more Southern maybe than I even do, just for the fun of it. The thing that was great about that scene that popped up was that it was like regional stuff was like considered cool. I think the Southern thing was a plus, where it wouldn't have been a few years earlier.
You know, we had a way of being fairly charming, I think, and I think that people were sort of amused at the idea of a culture that provided us with Black Oak, Arkansas would also provide us with the DBs, who were considerably different.
I've been in New York for a year or so. I mean, I wasn't there for too long, but I was there 79 and 80, and I was around the scene there, you know, and it was fine. But I don't know, it was a little bit crazier down here in some ways, in a way that was kind of good.
It wasn't as brusque as New Yorkers. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't as hey man as LA. We were just Southern kids that grew up with good upbringing and politeness.
I think a lot of the Southern bands were better songwriters. Just my opinion. It just seemed like we could craft songs better.
Southern bands did not eschew the guitar as rigorously as some of the more influential acts in New York and Los Angeles, I think.
Seems like they were a little more fancy bands, you know what I mean? Like bands like the DBs wrote these kind of mature songs, and you know what I mean? They were like bands that had made a whole bunch of records at that point, even though they hadn't.
It all just felt very natural. And that's what we wrote our songs on. And I think you would find that throughout the South. I don't know if that's leftover back porch mentality of sitting around.
Being from Birmingham, I think we always kind of felt like what we sounded like spoke to Birmingham being like kind of an industrial Southern city. We reflected that, I think, somewhat. We weren't as jangly as, say, you know, REM or some of the other acts. I mean, we definitely had a little more nastiness about us.
Because of where I was from, here in Athens, you know, the birthplace of, Southern women in music, perhaps. I don't know. I was never made to feel that there was anything that I couldn't do. I didn't get that feeling until I went to some other places.
I think if I'd stop and think about, okay, here I am, I'm 18, I'm a girl in Mississippi, I probably would have just called the whole thing off. No, I just thought, this is what I want to do. Some of that caused a fire that helped push this all along.
I think a lot of what happened with bands of that era is you were very much a product of where you came from, and so for us, we were kind of a product of being from nowhere.
Pearland was a very small town. It was almost in the country, even though it was a suburb of Houston. It felt like, you know, Dorothy in Kansas or something. I mean, we really felt out there.
Where we were in Jackson, Mississippi, I can remember feeling kind of isolated down there. We're like, you know, all these bands on the West Coast were running each other all the time, and we'd see them every few months.
You know, it was being outside of the national scene and either coast, but also being out of the Texas scene and being out of the Austin and Houston scenes, being from Pearland. So we felt very isolated.
We did.
Because we all felt like we're just adrift in outer space in a lot of ways, you were pretty free to be eccentric.
I mean, we were paying a lot of attention to what was going on because, I mean, it really was sort of this sort of exciting thing for a little while. Yeah, I mean, because we weren't in the middle of everything all the time, I think it did kind of leave us free to make our own messes.
I don't think you had any of this sort of mentality of like, they've got a hot singer, we got to copy his moves. I mean, that's sort of like stupid kind of, what we considered stupid showbiz, was completely off the map. It's like, you got to be kidding me, we're not going to do what they do, because they're doing it, being a little different, and not being mainstream. We realized needed to be our thing.
You do end up, you know, developing this sort of do-it-yourself attitude that, and I'm sure other people in other places felt that way too, but I'm sure if you were like in lower Manhattan at the time, you didn't have to look far for inspiration. It's like, oh, well, this band's playing over there, and that band's, oh, there's all this great stuff going on. Whereas for us, we really kind of had to dig deep.
The other cities had all of that going on, and we would have, this would have been small potatoes, you know, in that sort of scene. We wouldn't have, we wouldn't have probably registered it all in the scale.
You know, there was no CBGBs, there was no 40 or even a 40 watt club in Birmingham. I don't think we were as jaded, and it was definitely more of a DIY kind of approach to it. Down to even like little fanzines that, you know, some of the local artists and friends of ours were doing at the time.
It's very about much about why, because ain't nobody else, you know what I mean? So you got to do it, you got to make it happen. And I mean, it was great. It was, all it does is it just takes the idea of getting out there, and then people just appear doing cool things.
It was very hands-on. Our first single, we didn't know how to get professional record covers made, so we photocopied or had printed the outside cover on regular colored paper, and we cut it out by hand and folded it over and glued it for all 500 records.
We had the whole spectrum of the little, you know, photocopied fanzines and all that stuff, just super local, kind of good.
Anything that happened, you did it yourself, because the avenues are not here. You want this, you make it happen yourself. There are some who have the talent, who have the ability to go out and really make that happen in a giant way. Tim Lee's an example. He's got it. He's got the smarts. He's got the talent. He makes it happen.
I think I personally developed a very sort of, well, I'll just do it myself kind of attitude, because I didn't want to sit around and wait for other people to do it. And I could see that in, you know, bands like the Primatons and later Carnival Seasons. So people really were just kind of willing to just make their own way if they had to, instead of waiting for the music business to come to you or something, you know, come knocking on your door, offering you all this money. You're just going
to
play.
We're going to move to New York and get a record contract. Mostly it was just about the playing. We were just kind of having fun.
In my 30s, I kind of felt like I'd been beating my head against a brick wall, because everything had changed and it had become more about getting that record deal, and it's all anybody talked about after a while. I walked away and stayed away for a while.
I probably did put an end to my performing out and playing probably in the run, maybe early 90s, writing and just doing my own, playing on my own. And that's satisfying at the time.
Presently, still doing the DBs, but that's kind of my last act for music at this point. The business has changed so much that it's hard to figure where my place is in it anymore.
I have been playing some in recent years. In theory, I really still like to do it. I don't expect it to really mean anything, but it means something.
Now that I have no connection to any kind of business or music business or anything, I have way more fun than I ever did. I mean, I'm just having a blast playing. So it's, I get what I want out of it. And it's not money or acclaim or anything like that.
In recent years, we've done two reunion type shows. And then in 2010, Arena Rock Records re-released all of our stuff.
We got back together in 2004. DFA Records contacted us. So he wanted us to be the first band that they did a reissue for.
We do work together, not as so much as the Judys, but sometimes there'll just be special projects, or Jeff sometimes has projects come up and he'll ask me or Dane or both of us to work on it. And if we're gonna, sometimes we go in and we record tracks for something, maybe a future Judy's project.
Greg Glover at Arena Rock has actually talked to us about doing a new album, but you know, logistics kind of make that difficult. But we've thrown a few songs back and forth to each other.
Chris and I did a couple of records together and decided some of the songs that we'd come up with would be really good in the context of the DBs. So we got in touch with Will and Gene, and they were amenable to it, and we have been working on a record which is going to come out in June of 2012 called Falling Off the Skies.
We all still are more or less alive and everything, you know, and like, you know, we still play on each other's sessions and stuff like that. Peter's the guy that connected me to REM, you know, all this stuff's really been kind of cool.
I think it's like a marriage that's ended, but you have children, and so, you know, you're always in each other's lives or something.
We were coming up on our 30th anniversary, and that month our guitarist, Randy Bealey, he passed away. So that was the end of Pylon. But, you know, our music is still there, and I think it's important, if people like Pylon, you know, to continue to listen to it sometime, because I'd hate for people to forget about Randy.
I see a lot of people, and I read a lot of things about people saying, Yeah, I listened to the DBs when I was a kid or when I was in high school, and I decided I'd start a band. That's great news. That makes me feel like my job is done. That is what I was supposed to do.
I can't speak out with... Even when we were putting out our own records, we were sending records to the college labels and the fanzines. And, you know, again, as part of that thing of there only being X number of bands doing this, it was easy to get in because it's like, oh, there's something new. Yay. You know, now it's like, now I'd be like, oh, no, not another new thing.
There is that weird sort of thing about scarcity, you know, and so we did get to benefit from that weird thing of like sort of breaking through that sort of scarcity thing, like there's nowhere to go, there's nowhere to play, nobody cares about us, so all of a sudden people are really looking for this kind of music. And that kind of energy, but also that sort of pent up thing about it being hard to get, was apparent and really kind of awesome.
It was so rewarding too when you could find those things, or even if you just met somebody else that liked the same music you did because it was so unusual. And I just wonder if you find that in any corner anymore, or if everybody's just like, everything's everywhere.
I could feel like by the late 80s even, it was just different.
There was no internet, there was no any of that.
That does change a lot of things. So many people can go to put their stuff out that way now, and it gets heard by many, many, many. Well, that's an avenue that we didn't have then.
You really had to, you know, you had to get your hands on all those fanzines, and you had to dig around and, you know, record stores for those independent records and everything to even find out that it was being done.
It seems like it should be like so much better now, but nobody thinks it is. In terms of like, we can get this stuff so easily, that's great, you know, that should make music better and better, but I think it just is making people's heads down a little bit.
This doesn't strike me as being nearly as exciting.
It just doesn't feel like there's a whole lot of deep energy around shows.
I mean, that's a huge difference, I think, from today to those days, because it's hard to imagine it having that kind of... I have a hard time picturing people standing around at high school saying, did you see Nickelback? God, that was just dynamite.
You know, everybody knows there's no money in music anymore and stuff, but that was never the motivation. But you would think at a certain point it would have an effect on people.
Certainly the economic striation is a lot more pronounced these days, that you have to really be a blockbuster.
There has to be some kind of weird buzz thing going on or something, you know, and that's all manufactured. I think it's kind of rare that kind of thing really happens anymore, you know, on a real kind of just innocent level.
I don't think those kind of like explosion kind of scenes are likely to happen in this climate. But what are you going to do? You can't go back. You can't put a quota on this stuff.
Hopefully the allure of having a band is fresh enough to make it worth their while.
There's always, you know, somebody in a garage.
And if there's a sound people are really excited about, they're gonna freak out all over.
Turn around, I wonder if it's all to where is it me.
I think music in the 80s, you know, not necessarily the mainstream, but, you know, I definitely think the indie, you know, 80s music scene had a lot to offer.
It's interesting how the South really came on strong then, you know. Southern input was really important.
I definitely think it was a pretty unique period of time.
I mean, this whole thing has lasted way longer than it was supposed to, you know. In 1956 or so, this was supposed to be a fad that had about 18 months to go.
We didn't play that for that long. The Germans were a short-lived band, but a very powerful band, it seems. Many years later, I'm really realizing that.
We don't have to have our own wing in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, but, you know, if we end up as a footnote, that's fine. You know, we went, I like to say we went from upstarts to also-rans to influential without the benefit of actually selling very many copies of our records.
We didn't get famous or anything, but we sure had a good time.
We always had a lot of fun. You know, I hate to sound like the drummer for Spinal Tap, but we did have a good time all the time. We tried to.